Hello and welcome to the episode 72 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Among other stories, today we'll focus on a possible first meeting between the four Beatles, several recording sessions, and some filming at Gatwick. On the 13th of March 1958, Alan Caldwell's Texans, the Quarrymen, and other local bands performed at the opening night of the Morgue Skiffle Cellar in Liverpool. The venue was run by Alan Caldwell himself, singer of the Texans, the band that would go on to become better known as Rory Storm and the Hurricanes. The venue was little more than a cellar in a Victorian house, with no toilets, a single bare fluorescent blue light bulb to provide light, and one electric fan to supply some fresh air. Yet, it was crammed with some 100 people on its opening night, beginning at 7:30 p.m. Eventually, and unsurprisingly, public safety concerns and noise complaints led to the venue closure after little more than a month of operation. Apart from being an historical curiosity, the night might be the first time in which John Lennon, Paul McCartney, George Harrison and Ringo Starr were together in the same room. There is some dispute on the matter, though. Mark Lewson states, for example, that the Texans featured Ringo Starr on drums, while other sources, including BeatlesBible.com, assert that Ringo joined the band much later. Similarly, Lewson states that the Quarrymen, at the time, featured Len Gary on Teach's bass, Eric Griffiths on guitar, Colin Hanton on drums, John Lennon on guitar and voice, and Paul McCartney on guitar and voice, and that Harrison auditioned for the band before the concert, playing Arthur Smith's Guitar Boogie Shuffle. According to Lewson, Harrison was rejected, since John Lennon felt that he was too young to join. This version of the events, though, is contradicted by the presence of George in the first known color picture of the Quarrymen, taken on the 8th of March 1958, as detailed in episode 67 of What a Fab Day. As usual with these things, it's hard to know for sure whose person recalls the events better and which source is more credible. On the other hand, it was extremely likely that Ringo Starr was performing for the occasion, if not with the Texans, with one of the many bands he was busying himself with at the time. George's presence during the night seems part of both versions of the story about him and the Quarrymen. And so, for what it's worth, I think that this was indeed the time in which those four lads from Liverpool were together and perhaps interacted with each other for the first time. Anyhow, let's move to 1961 with the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, performing their lunchtime concert at the Cavern Club and a nighttime dance engagement at the Liverpool Jazz Society. The latter concert also featured Jerry and the Pacemakers and Kingside's Taylor and the Dominoes. Both venues were in Liverpool. Another Cavern Club lunchtime concert in 1962 for the Beatles, still featuring Pete Best on drums. In 1963, John Lennon had to work despite his cold to overdub harmonica on Thank You Girl. The session was booked from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the EMI Studio 2 in Abbey Road. It took Lennon 15 takes to nail the part. The final version of Thank You Girl was assembled editing takes 6 and 13 and overdub take 17, 20 and 21, and then mixed down in mono and stereo. John, still voiceless, returned to bed. The other three Beatles instead reached York to perform twice at the Rialto Theatre with a package tour also featuring Rowe and Montez. For the second night in a row, George, Paul and Ringo walked on the stage as a trio. Just as a curiosity, notice that this was the second time the Beatles had played the Rialto Theatre in less than a month, the previous occasion being the 27th of February stop of the Helen Shapiro package tour, featured in episode 58 of What a Fab Day. In 1964, the Beatles were at the Gatwick Airport South at 10 a.m. to shoot two scenes for their first feature film, A Hard Day's Night. The first one was the one closing the film, with the band jumping on a helicopter, taking off and scattering promotional photographs of the group on the ground. In the afternoon, the Fabs were shot playing around on an empty helicopter launch pad and filmed from above for an aerial shooting. And this is the time in which I remind you to please be fab and support my effort to create more and better free music-related content. If you are wondering what to do, please visit www.simonmas.com/support to find out. No donation is too small, no comment goes unpunished, and even simply sharing the content with your friends will help me building a community of like-minded music aficionados. Thank you! On the 13th of March 1965, the Beatles and the crew of their second feature film departed from London on the 11 a.m. flight to Salzburg, Austria. After the landing and the greetings of some 4,000 fans and scores of local journalists, the band gave a press conference at a hotel close to the airport, before being brought to the Hotel Edelweiss in Obertauen, near the location where all the filming for the Austrian scenes would take place. In 1967, after almost a month, the Beatles returned to work on the overdubs for Good Morning, Good Morning. Today's session at EMI Studios in Abbey Road, starting at 7 p.m. and going on until 2:30 a.m., saw the overdubbing of a brass section onto the song. The work was courtesy of Sound Inc.'s Barry Cameron, David Glide and Alan Holmes on saxophones, John Lee, plus one unknown musician on trombones, and the Tom whose surname nobody could remember on French horn. Sounds Inc., previously known as Sounds Incorporated, was a group of musicians who had experience backing up American solo acts during their European tours. They had met the Beatles during their 1962 stay at the Star Club in Hamburg, West Germany, and they had been signed by NEMS in 1964. For their work on this session, they were paid £201, about £3,700 in 2020 money. According to Richard Lush, tape operator for the session, the final result had to be treated with flanger, limiter and compressor because John Lennon felt that the musicians sounded too normal. Comparing various sources, it seems that the 13th of March 1969 was a busy day of mixing and preparing master tapes for projects that would never see the light. It seems that today, perhaps at the Apple Studio, someone prepared a tentative master tape of the EP featuring all the original songs included in the Yellow Submarine LP, plus Across the Universe. At the Olympic Sound Studios instead, Glyn Johns continued choosing the best takes of the songs from the Gatwick sessions and mixing them down. Today, he focused on Maggie May, Shake, Rattle and Roll, Kansas City, Miss Anne, Lodi Miss Clodie, Blue Suede Shoes and You Really Got a Hold on Me. John's version of the album was never released, and of all the songs prepared today, only Maggie May ever saw the light of the day. Let's close this episode with another mixing session, this time in 1970. It was on this day that Sentimental Journey, the song, was mixed in mono at the EMI Studios between 12 noon and 1:30 p.m. The track was to be used in the filming of the promotional video for the album, even though Ringo never released the song as a single. This concludes today's episode of What a Fab Day. Tomorrow, we will talk about the first day of shooting on the Alps for the Help crew. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.